A great feature of MATLAB that really separates it from other programming languages is its ability to use not just scalars, but vectors and matrices also, with most of the functions that are built into MATLAB or the functions that you can create in MATLAB. So just to recap what we just looked at, we could use it as a calculator on simple things. We could take the sine of 60 degrees, like that. We could take log 10 of a number, like 100, and get 2 out of it, etc. So these were operations where I was just putting one argument, that 60 or the 100, that's what we call arguments, into those functions. But not only can it handle those single numbers, but we can make, we'll start with a vector, either a row vector or a column vector. So the way in MATLAB we can make a vector and fill it with multiple entries is by using the square bracket. So for example, if I put square bracket, and then I'm going to choose numbers at random here, and then end it with another square bracket, this is how MATLAB represents a vector. I can save that to a variable, just like I was doing before. I can say a is equal to 1684 in those square brackets. So now it's stored to the variable I just call little a, the vector 1684. Alternatively, you can store things as a, that would be a row vector, as a column vector as well. So if I want a column vector, let's say 9720. By using the semicolon, that tells it that I want a new row for each number. And we'll see more of that when we look at matrices in a minute here. But now we see the difference between how I saved A as a row vector and B as a column vector. Each has 4 entries, but A is horizontal and B is vertical. Again, I can save these into variables just like I was doing before. So that's one way, if we have specific values we want in our vector, of how we can create our vector. But let's say we want a vector with values that are just evenly spaced along some domain. And this is probably what we want to use if we want to take like the sine of something that varies in time or something like that. So let's say that I want to take store values of time from 0 seconds, and then I can go in steps of 0.1 seconds until I reach 5 seconds. So this is one way I can define my vector here. So to kind of break into pieces, with using this colon command, this first entry here, this 0, is going to be what's the first value I want in my vector. The middle number here between the colons, this 0.1, is what we call the step size. So I'm going to start at 0 and then increase in steps of 0.1 until I get to this last number here, 5. So if I press enter here, here's the output. So we can see that I've assigned to t numbers from 0 to 5 in steps of 0.1. So if this was measured in seconds, then this would be 0 seconds, 0.1 seconds, etc., until 5 seconds. So I didn't have to type all of these numbers individually like I did above here for A and B. It automatically put this step size of 0.1 between all of my numbers. Now, this is good if we have a designated step size that we want. Alternatively, I'll call something T2 here. I might not necessarily want a set step size like I want here of 0.1, but I might just want a set number of values between two numbers, in which case I can use an alternate approach. I can call that Linspace, or a linear space. And to use the Linspace command, actually before I get to that, why don't we look at another feature. Instead of doing doc, I can also use the command help, which I get kind of a shorter explanation of how a function works. So if we look at the Linspace command, and now I'm going to use it in a second here, reading through the help, if I look at that second line, I can use Linspace to generate n points between x1 and x2. So if I want t2 to be time values between 0 and 10, I can put those as 0 as my first argument, 10 as my second argument, and then the third argument, let's just say for whatever reason, I want 100 times evenly spaced between 0 and 10. Now I can define T2 as linspace 0, 10, 100. If I push enter, we see that I now have 100 values evenly spaced between 0 as my first entry and 10 as my last entry. I can quickly recall the last thing I typed in the command window if I press up. So let's say I want to modify this. I don't want 100, I want, for some reason, 250 equally spaced values between 0 and 10. If I push enter there, we see that there's a lot more entries here, but T2 starts at 0 and now has 250 evenly spaced values between 0 and 10. And let's look at how the workspace is operating for here. So A and B, there were only 4 values. It's telling me what those 4 values are. But if I look at T and T2, since they have so many values, the workspace isn't printing what they all are, but it's at least telling me the size. So T is a 1 by 52 vector, and T2 is a 1 by 250 vector. So for vectors and two-dimensional matrices, the first number is the number of rows, and the second number is the number of columns. So these are both row vectors because T, for example, has 51 columns to it, and T2 has 250 columns to it. Another way of defining our a vector is, instead of using a linear space, something we might find useful later is a log space. It works basically the same way as linspace, but we see that now everything is logarithmically spaced out between two values. And now here we want to be careful because the first value is going to be the exponent to 10, the second value is another exponent to 10, and then the third entry is going to be the number of values between those. So for example, if I want something called, I'll call it big A here, is the log space. So I want values between, for example, 10 to the negative third to 10 to the positive third, logarithmically spaced. I want 100 logarithmically spaced values there. Let's do it smaller so we can see the output, 25 values. Right, so it's a little bit tough to see in this display here, but it starts at 10 to the negative 3 and then puts logarithmically spaced values until I'm at 10 to the positive 3 here. So log space we're not going to use right now, but just be aware it's another way to fill in vectors. Right, so let me clear out everything I just did and start fresh and see how we can use vectors. So let's go back to a nice vector here. I'll define T. I'll use linspace for this. I want T to go from 0 to 10, and I'll have 50 values. So let's just say T is time again. I'm going from 0 seconds to 10 seconds, and I have 50 equally spaced values between those points. So a great feature of MATLAB is that not only can it handle and save a vector like this, but the functions, a lot of them, also can handle vectors. So let's go back to what we were looking at with just the arithmetic. Some of the built-in functions, for example, sine. I can take the sine not just of a single number, but I can take the sine of a vector here. You see, what it does is that individually it takes the sine of all 50 of those values and then gives me the output. So I don't have to sit there individually and say, what's the sine of 0? What's the sine of 0.2041? It does that all at one time. Very conveniently for what I want to do. And other things I can do with vectors, just similar to how I did in arithmetic, let's take t again. Let's say I wanted every value of t, I want to square it. Again, I don't want to sit there individually doing that, I want to do it all at once. But something we have to be careful of is, for a single number, we can use that arrow, that caret command, so caret 2, but on a vector that's not going to work. What we have to do is, when we're dealing with vectors and when we deal with matrices in a minute, is I have to use this dot command here. And what the dot is going to do, as we'll see in a second, is that it's going to tell it to do that operation to each element individually. So if I do t dot caret 2, I'm now individually squaring every element of t, and it's printing it out. So 0 all the way to 10 squared, individually, element by element. Also what I can do, again, showing t, I can always multiply, let's say, a scalar, 5, times t. And what's that going to do? It's going to take every value in t, and it's going to multiply individually by 5. So it's going to, all the vector and matrices operations adhere to the same rules you have for any other linear algebra. We can multiply a scalar by a vector, we can multiply vectors together, we can multiply scalars together, and matrices together, but we have to obey all the algebra rules. So if I made a second vector, let's say b, that only has 3 entries in it, I can't multiply t and b together because they're not their sizes don't match. However, what I can do is if I make another vector b that is also 1 by 50, but let's say different values, this will go from 50 to 240, I also want 50 values in it. Because t and b now have the same number of elements, we see that they're both 1 by 50 now, I can multiply them together, but let's see how it does this. I can't just do t times b, because again, that's not how matrix multiplication works, but what I can do is if I do t dot star b, it's going to take element by element, the first element in t times the first element in b, and then the second entry, it will have the second element in t times the second element in b, and it's going to multiply it through in that manner. So again, first elements multiplied together, then we see the second elements multiplied together, the third elements multiplied together, and that's okay. Also what we can see here is that t and b are both row vectors. I can actually do a transpose, and this will be also useful with matrices. If I use the apostrophe here, it's going to transpose my vector. And in this case, I can multiply t times b transpose, because in that case, the vector multiplication works. And this is actually equivalent to using a dot product. So if I do t, which is a row vector, times b transpose, which is now a column vector, that's the dot product of t and b, and that gives me a scalar quantity here, 4.5 times 10 to the negative fourth. Other things we can do with vectors, we don't have to use the whole vector at once. So let me make another b vector here, fill it with some random values. All right, so we see that b has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 values in it. However, I might, for whatever reason, only want to refer to certain values at a time. So what I can do is I can take kind of parts of the vector out and see what they're equal to. So let's just say I only want to know what's the first value, the first element in my b vector. Well, what I can do is since b is already defined, I see it in my workspace, if I do b parentheses 1, it's going to give me just the first value in my vector, which in this case is 1. I can do the same thing if I want only the second element in my b vector. We see that b of 2 gives me 5. And I can also take subsets here. So let's say I only want the second through the fourth value in b. I can do b of 2 colon 4. And this gives me only the second, the third, and the fourth value in that b vector there. So I can pull out only specific values that I want to use or that I want to check in my vector. If I just do b colon, that'll give me my original vector back. Finally, talking about vectors here, let me make another vector that has the same number of elements as b, which had 8. There should have the same number of elements here. We saw we can multiply them together, but we can also add vectors together just like we can do in linear algebra. They have to have the same size in order to add them together correctly, or I can subtract them. Begin just to refresh, I can't multiply them. However, I can do an element-wise multiplication. And just to show again, I can take their what would be their dot product by doing that sort of command there. All right, so that's how we can use vectors here. And we can also put vectors into a lot of the functions we define. And remember that we have to be careful that we might have to use that dot there to do certain functions. Again, example a dot caret 2 will now take every element of a individually and square it so that I can use it.